So we're back with another video of Do You Know What To Do? We're going to work on this bench today and show you how to change it from a button tuft to just a flat top. Right now it's button tufted and the client doesn't want that. But before we get started on any of our furniture, when the exposed legs, we like to clean them up, with exposed legs, that is. We like to clean them up. And we do that by using steel wool. This one right here is a number 3, extra fine. That's 3 zeros, actually. So 000. It goes up to, I think, 5. So that's a little finer. That's like extra, or super fine. We also use, I like to use, Old English. And it primarily comes in 3 colors, light, dark, and I think red. And this one is appropriate for this color. You put a little bit on the steel wool and clean up the legs, and it takes out minor scratches and does a great job. So Grant's finishing that up, and we're going to flip the bench over and show you what it is now and how we're going to change it to just a flat top. It's a button tufted. It's an actual order that we have from a client here. And this is the order that they sent us. This is a picture of it in the client's home. This is the fabric that's going to go on it. And as you can, I think you can see that there, and you're about to in a second, the button tufting on the actual bench. So you're finished, we can flip it over. So you can see this is the button tufting on the top of the bench, and the client doesn't want that. They want it to be a flat top. And we're going to still follow the design on the sides for the pleating, but she doesn't want the buttons in there anymore. So we're going to show you how to do that. And Grant's taking off all the excess oil. It's very important that you do that. You don't want to have any excess oil, because when you work with your top fabric and you're touching the legs, and then you end up touching your fabric, and you're going to get the oil on your fabric. So make sure you get all the excess oil off. So the next step is to start taking this cover off.
Okay, so we're going to show you the list of tools that we're going to use for this job. We're going to start off with the rubber mallet. You also have a staple puller, and then nips. This helps to pull up the staples. And also we have a pneumatic air gun, or air stapler. Now Dad's going to show you the more common tools that you can get your hands on.
Right. We always try to think of substitute tools that you could use, because we know you're not going to invest that much money in just taking care of one bench. So if you don't have these tools available, then what you could use is, say, a manual stapler that you can get at a hardware store. They're inexpensive. They're a little bit difficult to work with if the job's kind of big. So if you don't want to take that route, you can go back to the old school and do tacks. And you get a tack hammer. It's going to be very useful. And it has a magnet on one end, like that. And then you would simply just put it down in the piece of furniture, or the place you want to in the furniture, and then turn it around and tap it down. So you could do that. It's what they did for decades, way before the stapler came. Now, Grant mentioned the puller as well, and if you don't have that, we understand, then use a straight screwdriver. You can use a regular hammer too, that you would use for building something. You could do that. So you just simply put the screwdriver up underneath the staple to get it out, tap it, pull it up. Now, if you don't have nips, if you don't have these, what we use, and use needle nose pliers, or just any pliers. So once the staple's up, grab it, pull it out, and get it out of your way. And that's pretty much it. So those are the substitute tools, and these are the tools that we use in our shop. So don't want the investment? Try the substitutes.
All right.
So now what we need to do is take out all these staples here and get this dust cover off. This is what they call a dust cover. And the reason why, years ago, they would use hay or horse hair, which is still available, the horsehair is, it's rubberized, but years ago it would come in these big dusty bags, and people would work them in there, and then over time, using the furniture, it would break down and there'd be dust underneath the piece of furniture. Right, so they put these covers, that's why we call them dust covers. Save it. There's no sense in throwing it in the trash.
Mm-mm.
You know, try to keep as many things as you can out of the landfill. If yours is torn to pieces from a pet, then just get a piece of fabric. put up underneath there. Burlap looks kind of nice up underneath there. So that's what we need to do, is take off this tack strip, take all these staples out, take off this dust cover. We're going to save it and reuse it, and then start getting to the furniture, fabric rather.
All right, let's do it.
That's it. You know, it's a good idea to have a bowl, especially a magnetic one. It's really good to put all the staples that you pull out, because you don't want them to end up in your carpet, or if you got pets or kids, or ends up in your cotton, you know, that you're working with cotton or Dacron. You don't want a staple in your cotton.
No, sir.
Keep the staple out of your cotton. So get a bowl. And if you can, if it's not magnetic, maybe if you have a magnet around the house or something, just maybe like glue it to at the bottom or something. But that'll work out well.
So as you can see, we've taken off the tack tape, the dust cover. Next step is take off the cording or welt.
That's right. And we'll just move on from there. You know, a little small tip, if you're doing something other than a bench, if you're just watching this and you're going to tackle a chair or something like that, or a larger piece of furniture, this is rectangle. It's even. It's easy to be able to tell when you save this, if you can. Put a little B for the back of the piece of furniture. I know that may sound ridiculous, but when you go to put it back on, they're not always square, and you know, you're flipping the thing over. At least you know where the back is, B for back or F for front, so it doesn't make a difference. But I like to give as much information as I can on all the furniture.
Little tips.
Yeah, little tips and ideas of the furniture that we work on. That might help you, but you're not going to need it for this rectangle piece.
No, it's obvious.
Yeah. All right. Okay, so we're working our way up toward the leg here. And for the benches, furniture, whatever that doesn't have a skirt, they're going to put this welt or cording around the leg like this. Now, some people will hot glue it. They'll cut out the cording, which we'll show you later on, and they'll hot glue it down in here, or some of them will staple it. My point in telling you is be careful right around here, because this is going to be exposed. There's staples here and here and here. So whatever tool you're using, a screwdriver, if you have a puller, great. Just be careful that you don't go from this angle, you're going to scar it up. Don't dig down and scrape up like this, because you're going to hit it as well. Just take your time right around these legs here, so you don't damage the leg taking out the staples. There's also staples that hold down the top fabric around this leg. There's a groove that they put in, and they're expecting you to put some cording piping there. And there's a lot of staples there. You're not going to get them all. I mean, if you can, that's great. But if you can't, don't worry about it too much. It'll all work out. All right, say you want to take on the challenge of getting those staples out of the leg area in this groove here. You can use an upholsterer's regulator. That's what this is. If you can order those, they're easy to get. Or you could use a letter opener, but I doubt you have one of those. Or you could use a knitting needle, a strong one. I don't knit. Not planning on knitting either. So, but it might work. I don't know. So, what you got to do is get the regulator underneath a staple like that, and then it'll pull it out. This is strong enough to do it. At the tip, it's not. I'll bend it if I go too close to the end. So I try to get it in as far as I can, and then pull out the remaining staple. This one has too many for me to ignore here. And if you want to take it on, take it on. I'm tapping this in like this. I'm going to pull gently, pull it right out. So if you can find something that'll slide down in there, you want to take it on, take it on. Okay, so now we got all the staples out of the top fabric. We got everything off, okay? But the fabric's still attached because of the buttons.
So obviously the next step would be to cut the buttons free. So Dad's going to take his scissors, cut all the buttons free from the twine.
You know, they do have staples here holding the button twine. You can take them out if you want, but we're just going to leave them in. Or you can just cut them, just like Grant just now said. And that's how they do these buttons, by the way. They do what's called a slip knot. They put the cotton in. We're going to use some of this cotton to fill in the holes, and that's how we're going to do it. Okay, so let's cut all these free.
Right.
Okay, and another thing too, you got to pull this here. But just because I did this on the side, snipping that is, doesn't mean the button's free, because it's not. Okay, because there's a slip knot. So now it's free. Bet you couldn't see that, could you? So now you know it's free. All right, so let's do that to all of them and then we'll get busy.
All right.
So take all the twine, button twine out. We're going to use this cotton to fill in those holes. Sometimes they'll use fabric as the stop for the twine on the backside, or they'll use webbing. So you can't use that, but thankfully we have this and we're gonna fill these holes in with some of that.
So what we have here is synthetic cotton. It's clean and easy to work with.
It is. Compared to natural cotton, which I do like working with natural cotton, but the natural sometimes has seeds, little pieces of the stem still in there. And years ago, they used to really
clean it well,
and it was really nice. But we're not getting that as much as we used to. So synthetic, if you want something easy to work with, this is the way to go. Now, the reason why there's a difference is if you use a natural cotton and there's seeds, there's a bit of stem still in there, and you have a thin fabric.
You could feel them.
That's a problem. Right, you can definitely see. And I've seen it where it's kind of a white, and it's so thin, the fabric, which you should, you know, have an under
foundation fabric,
thank you, and that's what we're going to do here, that you could see the cotton underneath it. So it's not, this is white, they're bleaching this. So that helps.
Okay.
Where the cotton is kind of an off-white, has seeds, a little bit of stem, not so good. You could do this in two different ways if you want to change it from button tuft into a flat top. You could replace this foam altogether and just put a new piece on. Problem is, this will end up in a landfill and it's still useful. So it's got many more years left. So we like to do it this way. It's pretty deep because what they do is when they do button tufting, they cut a hole straight through the foam from the top to the bottom. So if the foam is 3 or 4 inches, well, then that's how much cotton you have to fill up in there. So we use the cotton that was holding the buttons or keeping the buttons from slipping underneath, and it only took up to 3 holes, or it took 3 holes.
Yeah.
It only took us to 3 holes. So we got some more cotton and keep on filling these holes in, and that's what we're doing now.
Yeah, so you're definitely going to have to buy some more cotton.
Right, you're going to need cotton. Don't use anything other than cotton. Don't do like batting unless, I don't know, you can really put a lot in there. If that's all you have, use it. Just put a lot in there. Make sure it's really tight.
Yeah.
Okay. So when we were working on it, we started realizing that it's sagging in the middle, and that's going to be noticed by the client. So we've looked at the webbing, and we can tell that it's loose. It really shouldn't be that loose. It looks like it's stretched over time. One thing that they did that I wouldn't like to copy, I think it's important to weave it in and out. So this one here would go underneath here, and then this one would be in its same position, but then that one would go underneath here. And you do that for each one, kind of like a basket weave, and it gives it more stability. They didn't do that. If you do webbing, I would do it with the weaving pattern. I think it's going to be better. So we decided to use new webbing because it was sagging way too much. As you can see, their original webbing or their foundation, look how much of a difference it is from what Grant and I did. And this is a basket weave sample. This is jute webbing that we used here. This is the basket weave of jute webbing. For example, this one's on top, talking about this strip here, on top. This one's underneath, top, underneath, top. And then the ones going this direction, same thing, underneath, it's on top, and then underneath. So weave it like that, and that gives you more stability, each one supporting the other. We're still going to put a fabric on top of here. We don't need a heavy-duty one. In fact, let me tell you this. If you want to skip the webbing, you can. But you're going to have to get a heavy-duty, thick, heavy-ounce canvas, maybe denim, something like that that you can pull really tight and staple. Some heavy-duty burlap. You can do that as well, and you can skip this. If you're using a burlap, maybe like put 2 layers, maybe 3 heavy duty. You can do that with any fabric. Don't get something that's lightweight, can tear easily, or is not has a lot of strength behind it. Don't do that, okay? You could skip the webbing and use those fabrics if you like, but the jute webbing's the best.
Yeah.
So we're still gonna put a fabric on top, and for 2 reasons, okay? One, jute webbing against foam eventually starts to tear it down. And also, since we have these holes that go all the way through the foam there, we're putting the cotton in, well, what do you think is going to happen? Eventually, it's going to fall down into the pocket, right, in between the webbing. So this is a light-duty That's all you need, something simple, fabric, nothing heavy duty. And that's just going to keep these pieces of cotton from falling all the way through. So that's it.
All right, let's get started.
When you're putting on your webbing, get a longer staple. What we use is 9/16 staple, not a 3/8. 3/8 is standard for your upholstery, 9/16 for your webbing. It goes in deeper, holds stronger. They make webbing tacks too if you're using tacks. So get webbing tacks, okay? Now that we put the foundation fabric and the new webbing in, it's very firm, very straight, but we're probably not going to need as much cotton because it was falling into pockets. What you can do too, just like the factory did, is you pinch the bottom of the foam and shoot a staple down in there, and that'll hold it in place. Or you can glue the bottom if you want. Either one works. Okay, what do you think, Grant, as far as the foam now?
Not too bad.
It's a huge difference. It's a major difference, right?
Decent dark.
So what we're doing is we're going back over the holes again, putting more in if needed, taking some out and others, and starting fresh. Big difference. This thing's like it's brand new. So, in fact, I personally believe it could be maybe a little bit better than when it was new.
Probably.
Yeah. They're going to like it. Now that we've feathered out all the cotton on top, now we're going to put down a foundation fabric. Simple, white, easy to work with muslin. And what that does is helps shape the bench or ottoman or a piece of furniture that you're working on, so your top finish fabric doesn't have to do all the work. So we're going to pull this over just a little bit like that. We're going to staple it down, Grant and I are, and get the shape of the ottoman the way we want it to be. And then when we put on the top fabric, which has a pattern, we're not pulling and pushing
struggling.
And struggling trying to get the pattern to line up. This fabric has already done it for us. Plus, it's going to help keep the cotton looking smooth and flat. So that's our next move.
So we're back on a different day to finish this ottoman.
Right, it's looking good and smooth, and we're on a different day because we didn't have the top fabric before. So now we do. So we just went to the stage that we could, and that was put the muslin on.
All right.
And as I mentioned before, this is the shape of the ottoman. This is what we want. This muslin did all the work.
Right.
Okay.
So your top fabric will be exactly the same.
But before you take it this far, it's important
to remember not to push down the cotton too far because it feels like golf balls when you sit on it.
Yeah, it does. Because the foam wants to compress and the cotton doesn't. So I mentioned earlier, if you're going to be using batting, if that's the only thing you have, great. You can put a lot of that in there because that's going to be more... have more buoyancy or more flexibility than cotton. Cotton's pretty hard when you put it together. So don't overpack the holes with cotton. Test it before you take it this far. Sit down on it and see if it's comfortable to you. Okay?
All right, let's get started.
So the next step is take a single blade or single edge blade razor, and you're going to have to cut away this fabric, the muslin foundation fabric, and the top fabric the same way we're doing it, or something that you're going to be able to get rid of this fabric in this groove. You're most likely going to need more than one razor blade because as soon as you hit a staple, it's over. It dulls the blades like that for some reason, and a dull blade is a dangerous one. So we're going to cut all this off and then get to the top fabric. Okay, so we finished taking away the muslin fabric here in the corners, and now we're going to move on to the top fabric.
All right, so before we start with that, we're going to take some Dacron and for added security.
To get rid of the lumps,
what
have you.
We'll put this on top. You can put it on the sides. Mm-hmm. But we're just going to glue this down and continue on.
Yeah, perfect. We're just going to do the top like you just said. So what you can do, too, with Dacron is it comes in different sizes. So if you don't have a quarter inch, because that's pretty much surface Dacron in upholstery is a quarter inch thick. That is, and you just lay it on top, and it gives it kind of like Grant just said, a smooth feeling. And if you have the inch, you can take what is called bonded Dacron, not resin Dacron, but the bonded will split, so you can cut it down like that to different sizes. just like that. But it doesn't always work out so well. Sometimes this will be a lot thinner than this one, so you got to go kind of slow. It depends on the quality of the Dacron. I found some that work beautifully, and others, this is impossible. I mean, it's a disaster. So you can make it work if you want, and that's what we did with this piece. This was a full piece.
Right.
And we slowly just pulled it apart like this to the thickness we want. Now, when you do that, Grant perfectly laid it like he always does on top, the factory side. You don't want to do the split side, because see, these little pieces, sometimes they'll bunch up and you might feel that. So, as Grant said, we're going to glue it down. That's the next move. You can use any like foam glue that you get at like a craft store or something. We're going to use our gun here, and we're going to lay this direction and spray this and the ottoman. So we're going to spray the Dacron and that, both surfaces. Set it in place. Pull it so it's not rippled. So you want it to be pretty tight, pretty smooth. And then cut off the excess as you pull through. Okay, so don't make it all loose like this. You're going to see it when you start pulling down your top fabric. Okay, our next move is to get the size of the top fabric. So we're going to show them how to do that.
All right. First of all, we start off on this side. Attach it down to the bottom.
Got it.
Get the measurement. It's 57 and a half, so we're going to say 58. And
okay.
Plus 5 is 63.
Right. Always 5 inches. Minimum 5 inches. Okay, yeah, so that's 2.5 on each side. Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So we're going to do the side now.
Okay, got it.
That'd be 33 and a half, so we're going to do 34, so that'd be 39.
39, okay, so 39 inches. So now what we have, like 63 by, would you say 39?
Yeah, 39.
Okay, so that's what we want to cut out, okay? And that'd be the minimum, because you want to, you know, if you make mistakes, you want to be able to move it over just a little bit. And if you're going to be doing a pattern too, then you're going to want to get your center point, okay? Go to what pattern, of the pattern on your fabric, what you think looks good, and then work out from there.
Right. Pick your center point on the fabric, too.
Exactly. So the left and the right, or the left and the right, and the front and the back, that type of thing. So you know how to do it. Just adjust it from your pattern out where you want it to be centered. Now, say you don't have a flexible tape like this, because a lot of people have like a ruler or something like that, or a metal tape that doesn't want to bend, you don't want to break it, take a string. And go from one end to the other, and then lay out your string, and then and put it against your ruler, or you know your measuring device, and then do it that way.
Just don't pull the string too tight.
Right. So, all right, very good. So what we're going to do now is show the fabric that we have here. I've already cut it. So here's the fabric that we're going to use, and it's a very wide pattern. So we just picked what we thought might look decent in the center, and that's what we're going to focus on the ottoman here, this part of the fabric. Or pattern. So we notch the fabric in the center simply by folding the ends together and then notching the center. And we did it there on the sides, and we did it here as well. Just fold it over, notch it. We made our marks on the ottomans, the center marks right here. I got a little small pencil mark. I got it on this side and that side as well. So we know that these notches need to line up with those pencil marks on the ottoman. Now this is where we really are fortunate, because this fabric, the way it's running right now, is salvage, or the end of the bolt.
To salvage.
To salvage, exactly. And it is, what did we say, 60-something?
It's 63.
63 wide, right? Well, we needed that to go from one end of the ottoman to the other end of the ottoman.
Right.
Okay? And this is how you would lay it up on this ottoman or bench, is you would go up like this, and then on the side you'd staple it. Average fabrics are 54. Inches. So we would have to put a seam in here, because this has a pattern. But if you're using a fabric that has a print or a pattern and there's a definite up, then you're going to have to seam in appropriately your fabric so it continues the print or the pattern is a continuous look.
Right.
Okay. Where we don't have to do that. Thankfully, I already forgot the number now, but it was 60-something.
63.
So it fits, so we don't have to do anything. Woo! But if you need to, you could railroad it. This one is somewhat random, what we call a random pattern. You might have a random print, meaning like the best example is like vines. Who knows what's up and down with a vine, right?
Right, yeah.
So you can turn that thing anywhere you want and you're good. If you have a solid, then there's no sense, and it's 54 inches, don't seam it in. Just do this here and run the fabric this way onto your bench or ottoman or any piece of furniture you're using for that matter. This is called railroading the fabric because you'd be cutting from this direction.
Right.
So I hope that makes sense. We'd make it wide enough where it fits over top of the bench. You see, if we were railroading it, and obviously we don't have enough because we're not doing that. Okay? So then you wouldn't have to worry about any seams since your fabric's 54 inches wide. So we're good to go. We're just going to simply line this up on our notches and the pencil marks on the ottoman bench here and start stapling.
All right, let's do it.
Okay, so now that we have the fabric laying up here, we have the notches lined up with our half marks on the ottoman. And what we're going to do is anchor it. And you want to anchor it on all sides because when you start really stapling on this side and that side's not anchored, you're going to start pulling it and you're going to see your pattern start to shift. So that's what we're going to do first. We're going to do about three on each side, one in the middle, two on the sides here, same on this side, and probably two on the ends here, and then really start working this side, leaving those anchors in on the other sides. Okay, I'm going to show you what an anchor staple is in case you didn't know. I know I told you to put them in here. So I'm going to demonstrate on this cardboard tube. It's just taking your stapler and just tilting it to one side like that the best you can, and then it's easy to pull back out with a pair of pliers or nips like that. So if you go straight down, obviously you're going to be fighting a lot more. That's a permanent one. So an anchor one is that, or a tack that's not all the way down. Okay, so what we're going to do is always start in the middle of your piece and work your way to the ends or to the legs here. And when you go down, I want you to smooth out the best you can going on down to the legs. So you want to kind of come down and then over a little bit. And use your hand to smooth things out, okay, because that really helps out a lot. So I'm going to do that by starting in the center, working my way to this leg, starting in the center, working my way to that leg. It's anchored over there, so when I pull, it really shouldn't distort it very much. And then we're going to do the same thing in the on the sides, starting in the middle, going to the legs, and then when we get to the legs, we're going to stop and show you what to do
for the corners.
The corners. That's it. Perfect.
All right.
Okay, so now I'm back on the other side of the ottoman. You can smooth it down from the top on down. We're going to put an anchor in the middle there. I took the other one out and just pulled it down even more and put another anchor there. But this one right here, I'm going to take out this anchor and start pulling the fabric this direction and then down. Now be careful if you have a stripe, because if you have a stripe and you pull down and towards you, just keep checking it. It's a touch and go, situation, because you don't want it to be
distorted.
Skewed right and distorted. So if you're using a stripe or a pattern that's obvious, going to look messed up. If it's distorted at all, slow down and take your time.
All right.
Okay. So now I've established this up to about this point. Now I got to do this side. I'm going to work this direction doing the same thing and smooth your hand off, trying to get all the wrinkles out the best you can as you work your way toward the corners.
One of the important things that my dad's doing is he's checking for evenness all around so that everything's level, nice and smooth, that nothing's being pulled too tight in one area, especially around the corners. Once when we finish the corners, we'll show you this, is that one could be higher than the other ones, but
definitely.
You just have to work it out and it'll be fun.
Definitely, because sometimes, like he just said, I may pull more here.
And I might pull just a little bit right there.
Right. What makes it hard, too, when the foam is old, is someone sat more on this end than they did on that end or whatever, putting their shoes on all the time. So this one's going to give away more if they use this side the most.
Right.
So just keep an eye on that. Okay, now I've done three of the legs already. I'm going to show the last one. It's obviously the same method. So what we're going to do is, first of all, for people using this type of stapler, it is going to be a very difficult thing for you to be able to get. It's going to be impossible for you to get inside that groove. So the thing I suggest you to do probably is staple right up in here the best you can. So it's going to be a bit of a challenge. Hopefully it'll work up in there. But when you get your fabric in its place, which is going to be, you know, a difficulty, then you're going to staple like this because you're not going to get it down that groove. I'm using my air nailer or stapler and getting it right in that groove because I have a bit of a nose on my gun. That's a professional gun. So if you're using tacks, get like a number 2, a number 3. They're very small. Just put the tack in the same spot right there. Okay? So moving on, I've already done the four corners. This particular style, there's two ways you could do it. The easiest I recommend you doing is probably this style, okay? And then make it look neat, you know, work it and everything like that. Probably that's the easiest style. Well, that's not how the original one was, so I like to stick to the original upholsterer's plan. So what we did is the reverse of that, and it's going to be this style. Now, you might like that better. I mean, that is kind of nice. But you got to work it a little bit, and this is one that's completed here. This is a little tough fabric because this is literally like some kind of a cord that they make this pattern out of, and it's tough. So this has a lot more bulk compared to this side. So it's wanting to fight me while I'm trying to make these inverted pleats, but you probably don't have that problem. So this one, you know, it's not easy. And you know, the truth is, it's not going to be easy for pretty much any fabric. The trick to good upholstery, in my opinion, is you learn from your mistakes. You just keep on doing it until it looks right. So have very, very high standards and keep on working it until you get it. And then eventually it's going to look beautiful. So that's what we're going to do now is the last leg here. I like to pull it down like this here. Okay. And the groove is underneath here. I don't want to pull too much. That's why I like using the foundation fabric because it's already done it for me. I'm holding it on both ends because I want this kind of even. That's what I'm going for. And like I said, you just keep on working until you get it. Coming down a little bit. I'm holding it on that end too. One there. I want this to be smooth. Kind of going for something like this here. I got to work these wrinkles out, of course. Just like that. So I'm going to cut over here. See, this is a problem for me. This is a lot of tension right here and none right here. So it's putting a bit of a fight up, but I'm coming in from this direction, not that direction. Going to the other end here. And then here's the corner of the leg. I'm going to loosen that up some. I'm going up to that groove. And then just fold it back on itself like this here. That looks pretty good. I'm just going to go to the end. I got this, I don't know if you can see, I got this point right here I need to work on too because that's bulking up a little bit. So I'm going to snip the fabric right up to the end of the leg. And just keep an eye on the wrinkles in all directions. I'm going to have a problem right over here, I can tell you that.
You don't want to pull too tight. See, that's too much bulk. Then I got a little puckering going right there. So what I want to do is I want to, this part that's coming over, I'm going to snip right here and put back up underneath the leg like that. I'm hoping that'll get rid of that pucker. So I'm going to snip right there, put this up underneath the leg right there. Let's staple this down more in that groove, and hopefully that helped. I'm going to pull this in, fold it on itself. That does look better. So you can see it starts to get real bulky inside of here, doesn't it? Let's put another staple right here. Perhaps, now see this one I'm going to staple. I don't know if you can see that. This part I'm going to staple. I might just want to clean this up underneath here because we don't want all that thickness in there. Make sure I don't get both fabrics. Roll that over. I'm going to free this up. You just basically work with it until you start to get it where you want it to be. The piece that's folding over, I'm trying to free it up. I want to cut right here to relieve it some so it can fold back easier. I like that. I don't want to pull too much because watch this, it'll get all wrinkly. So don't pull too much, just keep an eye on that. I'm folding in and pulling this direction. Let's see if I can get it up in that groove there. Okay, that one was a little bit more of a fight than the other one, but I did the exact same thing as I did on the first one that I showed you on the other side. So I'm going to steam this. Should release some of the wrinkles. Looks good. And that's it. Then we're going to move on to the cording. Now we're going to show you how to do the cording for the bench. This particular fabric is very expensive. So usually you would cut it on the bias so it stretches. That is the cording once it's been cut. Okay. But on a small piece like this, we only need about, I can't remember. I think it was 180 inches or 120 inches or something like that. So I am not going to cut all this beautiful fabric up for this small job, which could be used for throw pillows or something else. So you can make cording running it across the salvage side. You don't have to. It's best when you can put it on the bias, and that would be from, say, this corner once you cut it to, say, 54 inches, which is a lot of cording you could use, to the other corner. And that gives it a nice stretch, see, like that. Whereas when I cut it this away from salvage to salvage, it doesn't have any give at all. And you want your cording to have give, especially when you're going around corners on cushions. Cut it on the bias. It's definitely the best. This bench, it's not going to make a difference. Plus, I'm saving a lot of money not chopping up all this for a little bit of cording.
And you're going to have way too much excess.
Way too much. So what am I going to do with that? So, wise way to handle this situation. Always make an arrow as to the direction that you are going to keep your cording going in the same direction that is. So when I go to the table, sewing table, and put these together, I have the arrow going here and then the arrow on the other end there. And I'm going to sew these two together. So across there, flip it over, and that's the way it goes. And then we're going to use a paper cording, which is an upholstery cording. It's literally made of paper. It's okay because it's not going to be washed or anything like that, this would fall apart once being wet. So it's okay with a upholstery that's stapled down.
Because you're not going to put it in the washing machine.
Right, not good for cushions. So don't use this for cushions. Use mop cording for cushions because that can be get wet and then still keep its structure. Okay, that being said, we're going to go over to the sewing table. Once again, 5/32 is the standard size welt or cording that you're going to be looking for. Your strips are 1.5 inches wide. We have this little piece here, this wood that I made a long time ago, got at a hardware store. Actually, it came this size. It was by chance, 1.5 inches. And when you end up folding this over for the sewing, it leaves approximately 1/2 inch. And that's standard with your sewing. Okay?
All right.
So let's go to the table and get it sewn. So here we are at the sewing table, and we got the arrow facing you. And I'm going to take the other one, find its arrow, and that too will be facing you. So we're going to make that up. We're going to take this one, turn it face up, arrow facing you, get the backside, no arrow. We want it connected like this. But instead of just doing it like this and having a straight line, it's best to do it at a diagonal. Take this one, turn it like this. So there's a crossing there. Turn it into the sewing machine like this at this corner. You want to start at this corner and sew to that corner. Don't forget the back stitch because it's going to fall apart on you. I do a tight stitch too. Don't forget, do as tight as you can because when you pull these open, you don't want to see the cording. You will see that paper cording where you join them together. That looks terrible. So make sure you get a tight stitch on this. Back stitched. Pull it out. We're going to trim this little excess off. I do like maybe 1/4 inch or so. 1/2 inch, whatever. Right there, just like that. Look at that. Then we're going to open this up. And that's pretty tight. So you can't see in between there. Now, if that was a loose stitch, like I said, you're going to see that cording. When you put it down in there, you're going to open that up and you're going to see the cording. So you should be okay with a tight stitch. And then we're going to switch on over to a cording foot. You can use a zipper foot if you don't have a cording foot. A cording foot has a little groove.
For the cording.
Yeah, exactly. So it sits in there. But if you don't have that, you can use a zipper foot and get up close to it. That. You can start at either end. It doesn't make a difference. Put your cording in the center. Fold it over. Put it inside that cording groove. Put the two together like this. Back stitch. You can make your stitch a little wider now if you want. It goes a little faster. And go all the way down. Just try to keep it nice and tight. You don't want loose cording. You want it to be nice and snug. Try to keep them as even as possible. The two ends. And that's it. Finish it up and then we'll go back to the ottoman.
Now, as you can see, we just finished putting on the cording. Now, where you want to put the cording on the bench is right in the seam or the groove right there. And put it right at the edge of the bench or furniture. And don't put it too far away from the bench or the furniture, so don't pull it out too far, because that way you'll be able to see the seam and look loose. It doesn't look very professional. So get it as snug as possible, but not too far back either. You won't be able to see it. So we're finishing with that, and now Dad's going to show us how to do the cording.
Yeah, what we do on the cording area is to get around the leg is take your scissors. You're going to need some very sharp scissors, and get right up against this leg and snip to the stitches, and then cut about 1/8 of an inch away from your stitches. I don't know if that's hard to see on the monitor or not. About 1/8 of away from the stitches, wrapping it around here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a... Excuse me here real quick. I got to get in here. Snip that and then come over here. I'm pulling it a little bit and snip right here. Now I'm going to pull this back and trim it pretty close to the stitches. You don't want to cut those stitches. That would be a bad thing. You're going to have to hand sew that closed in if that happens to you. Like this. This cord in here makes it really tough. So we're going to glue this around. You will not see it like this when we turn this bench around or ottoman. So I'm going to glue right in there, just like I did this one over here. So I did these previously. You don't need to see that. When you, there's a little glue mark right there. You're not going to see that when we flip this thing over. Okay? And if you see something's pulled a little bit, like I see this is pulled a little bit too much right here, you can see the tension. I'm going to take this staple out and that staple and this one, and that should relieve that a little bit right there, because I don't want to see that little dip right there.
All right.
So if you see that, look for where you see tension is happening on the top fabric. We're going to relieve that real quick, because that'll look good. You don't want to lay down the bench and you see it kind of pull in, you know, sunlight coming in or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So we're going to relieve this, and then we're going to show you how to do this. Okay. So now we're going to hot glue this around the side here. And the first thing I want to do is staple according down up toward the leg, close to the leg. Now, here's a couple of things I want to tell you. If you're using a hot glue gun, you're using white fabric, that comes off when you just rub it. So don't hit it by accident. You can get this residue on your white fabric. Take a rag, too, and get it started, because sometimes the glue gun is holding back some, and you squeeze it, and it squirts out a whole bunch. So get a little trail going first before you start doing this, because you get too much glue on there, you're going to see it. So all I'm going to do is put a little, right, doesn't take much, okay? Don't do the whole thing yet. Do this.
One side at a time.
And see, I'm rolling this up like that, okay? I'm not having this cut mark of the cording facing down, so when the ottoman is turned over, you'll see it. I'm going to do the same thing here. Just a small bead is fun. In fact, that might be a little too much. So I'm trying to push it against the fabric first and then kind of rolling it up. But if you get too much, make sure you're not squeezing any out there. This we can, I can snip that off. Then, to keep it still, we're going to staple that right there. Now, before we finish this up, I want to explain this to you on the corner here. We said earlier that if you're using a stapler from like a hardware store, it's going to be hard. It's going to be impossible for you to get up in that groove, and that's true. And even getting a small tack in there is going to be difficult. So what you could do is this. You can take your staple gun. Let me move this hot glue gun. You can take your staple gun. You can staple as close as you can to the groove. Obviously, the cording would be gone. Close as you can to the groove of the leg, okay? And once you get it in place, you lay this down like, oh, I like it there. You hit it right there. Put your tack in. Then get in, use as little as you can, staples that is. Then get a decorative nail, these here, and you cover your staple up. Okay, and you would just do that right around the leg. If you want, you could do the whole thing if you want, if you like that sort of thing. But you're not going to be able to get that staple into that groove. That's going to be impossible. And to get a tack in there is going to be extremely difficult. So you can staple on the face and then get these decorative nails, which looks quite nice, and cover up your staple. So try to hit in the middle. The distance between the top of the nail and the bottom is a half inch, so try to hit right in the center of the where the nail is going to go, okay? You get the point. It's going to look nice. It's going to be good. It's going to be a lot easier for you to get it to stay in place, yeah. Okay? So that's one idea that I think is very good, because we try to make it where persons that don't have these tools can do this for themselves. Now, if you don't have a hot glue gun, I thought about that too. You can get something. This is a name brand called Liquid Stitch. You can do the exact procedure.
Okay.
Cut the cording down to very close to the stitches of the cording, and then put a slight bead there. Take your staple gun, and then staple it where you're anchoring it. That's actually backwards. Where you're stapling, you anchor it like that. Okay. So once again, glue instead of sitting there holding, waiting, because you're going to need about I don't know, 20 minutes or something for it at least to start grabbing hold, then just anchor it like I did with the staples. And that should hold it too. So there, if you don't have a hot glue gun, that's okay.
Yeah, and you can always get one at Michael's.
Oh, yeah, they're inexpensive, just in case you don't have one, but I'd get one. You could use it for other projects. Now we're going to move on to finishing up the cording here, and I'll show you how to do that. Okay, so one, you're going to clean up. We're going to snip this cording down to the last part of the stitching. I don't want it to unravel. Okay, so I just brought it back to here. And we're going to open this one up.
So as you can tell, you need small, sharp, pointy scissors.
Yeah, you do. You should get your scissors down here. Okay, I'm going to want a little bit more past that. Cut it even with this one here. Okay. Fold that over an angle. You can go straight on if you want. If you don't care, just do that then. I'm going to take this off here. This is a backed fabric. The designer had it backed. You can fold it over like this, meeting it up, and like that. Now you can grab the one underneath and pull. It's probably hard for you to see on the monitor, but you can pull the one underneath to make it tight and walk, while you staple, walk up toward it, meaning this. Okay, I'm going to pull this a little tight. See, I want to pull that one a little tight. See, I'm pulling this tail there, and it's making it nice and tight there. So you might have to work with it a little bit, but you get the point. You're going to get it. So now Grant's finishing up the dust cover, and what we're going to put on top of the dust cover is tacking tape. It's a half inch thick. Flimsy cardboard is all it is, but I want you to lay it right up in the seam of the welt, and that gives it a nice stiff feel. Whereas without it, it's very loose. Once this gets stapled down, it's solid. Put it right in there. Now, the reason why I want you to put it on top of the dust cover, because sometimes when you put the dust cover as the finished part and the tacking tape is under the dust cover, which is fine, you can see it sometimes, especially if you reuse the old one.
Like this one.
Right, exactly. See, like this is sticking up right here? If I have the tacking tape over top of it, it holds it down. And you're not going to see the
tacking tape.
Tacking tape, thank you. So that's a good trick, a good tip. So we're going around the legs here to hold it down as well. And I'm just about done. I'm going to snip that off. You shoot that down right there.
Yeah.
Go ahead and shoot that for me. So we went around the legs as well, and she's good to go. Okay. Well, she's finished, so we're done. That's how you change a button-tuft bench or ottoman into a flat top without getting new foam.
All right.
So that was a pretty good deal.
Right? Save the landfill.
Yeah, so now you know what to do when you want to do that.